Good morning, beloved church family. How awesome it is to be here again with you. The day after we had that wonderful celebration of the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we are so glad that you have come to join with us today for worship. Whether you are family, friends, the nursing facilities who join us, or you're a first-time visitor, Stephanie and I pray that this service blesses you. Let us say before we start our roll call for the nursing facilities that we are so delighted you have chosen to take a few minutes today to worship the Lord with us. Stephanie and I truly want you to know that we appreciate you so much for joining us today. We come together to honor our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So let us get started by saying hello to our friends at the various nursing facilities. At Castle Manor Nursing and Rehab, at Friendship Manor, at Windsor Gardens Convalescent Center, we want to say hello to you down there in National City. In Chula Vista, we want to say hello to our friends at Frederica Manor Assisted Living and Senior Retirement Community, and Canterbury Court Senior Living. Hello, you guys. In Bonita, we say hello to our friends at Sunrise Senior Living. Down by the water in Imperial Beach, we want to say hello to our friends at Sun and Sea Manor for Alzheimer's and dementia. And our home church in San Diego, we want to say hello to our friends at Ocean View Church and the senior class, the Summit. As always, we have prepared for you a verse of the day, which is Isaiah chapter 45, verse 5. It says, I am the Lord, and there is no one else. There is no God beside me. If your birthday was this month, and we missed you, and you missed us, we want to say happy birthday and be safe as you celebrate that special day. Happy birthday to you. Let us get started with a word of prayer. Would you pray with me, please? Lord God, we bless your name. We ask that you bless your children as we gather together to exalt you. We reject evil plots and sin in your name and pray for your grace so that we may do good works in your name, Lord. Father, we thank you for all that you have done in our lives, and we thank you for counting us worthy to serve you and know you as the only true God. Without you, our gathering would be in vain. Come, Lord, as we worship you. Let everything we do in our service and on each day of our lives be done to glorify your holy name forever and ever. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray, amen and amen. In the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 3, verse 5, it says, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything as being from ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God. Join Stephanie and I as we sing, I need thee every hour. It says, let love be your guide. Christ loved us and offered his life for us. He offered his love for us as a sacrifice that pleases God. Join Stephanie and I as we sing, My Savior's Love. My Savior's Love. Get ready. Here we go.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned and free.
participating in singing those songs. Jesus is our rock and has been forever. So when we get down and out, which we'll refer to my lesson today, when we get down and out and we feel like life is just not treating us right, all we have to do is pray. And Jesus will lift us up. And he'll lift up our spirits. Sometimes burdens of life get so heavy. The struggle gets hard. We just cry out to Jesus, "Hide me. Hide me." And thankfully he does, in his own way. The Lord is our rock. In him we hide, a shelter in the time of storm. Hallelujah. Whenever the world gives you troubles, gives you problems, or makes you afraid, put God's promises in your heart. You don't need to fear. The Lord is always with you. God is our secret, immovable hiding place. He is our special fortress. And whenever life overwhelms us, we can always run to him. Draw near to him, and he will draw near to you as well. Hide in his comfort and hide in his encouragement. Seek him through prayer. Keep your mind on him, because God's presence is near and you are protected. Look what it says in Psalm chapter 32, verses 6 through 8. This is what everyone faithful should pray at a time when you can be found. Then, when the flood waters are raging, they will not reach to him. You are a hiding place for me. You will keep me from distress. You will surround me with songs of deliverance, Selah. I will instruct and teach you in this way that you are to go. I will give you counsel. My eyes will be watching you. This song is called Hide Thou Me. Hide Thou Me.
Done for me.
I wanted to touch on a subject today dealing with letdown. Dealing with letdown. You know, we spend so much time building up to Christmas. It's gone. There's a letdown. What do you do now? You see, in this age of materialism and marketing plans that convince you to buy something you didn't even know you needed, it is hard to remember exactly why we celebrate Christmas. The obvious answer is that we are celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And yes, that is exactly what we are doing. But it cannot be a ritual that we go through every 12 months. It needs to be ingrained into who we are and what we do. Have you noticed how the day after Christmas is sort of a letdown? Christmas is an exciting time. You know, we look forward to the excitement around the tree, the family coming in, and the look of shock and surprise as loved ones and young kids rip open the gifts given to them. The days after Christmas involve taking the tree down and lights. It might mean a few days off from work or trying to figure out how to pay for Christmas. It probably also means New Year's resolutions, making future plans to diet or to get out of debt or to start a new job adventure. But is God in your future plans? By now, you may have the Christmas blues. Christmas, unfortunately, has a way of draining us and your pockets. You have get-togethers, parties, there's the shopping, running around, the hurry-scurry, there's church, choir musicals, there's visits to families, there's the tension and pressure that many feel. Yet, the new year, however, has a way of energizing us. The new year brings new prospects, new dreams, new plans, and the annual resolutions to diet and health, to get out of debt, and to try new things for the new year, or get better at something. But have you ever considered how backwards that all sounds? C.S. Lewis wrote, "The central Christian belief is that Christ's death has somehow put us right with God and given us a fresh start." That's in his book, The Care for Christianity. Christmas should ignite the soul with a passion for God. The new year invites us to think of new steps, new hopes, and new plans, including gaining a fresh start in Christ. But God's word already gives you that. For many, the first few days after Christmas can be a difficult time. For some, this post-Christmas blues syndrome begins almost immediately after all the gifts have been exchanged. The excitement that not very long ago seemed to fill the house as Christmas lights were unpacked and unraveled and the lights were tested now turns to dread and disappointment as the Christmas decorations now come down from the tree and are to be packed away for another long year. But let me tell you, it doesn't have to be this way. Of course not. at least not for those of us who are Christian believers, when we realize Christmas is far more than decorations and the gift giving. Then Christmas can be every day of the year, every day of your life. So then, what happens after Christmas? Well, let's take a look at what happened after Christmas in the book of Luke, chapter 2, the Christmas story. We're not going to read the entire passage. I'm going to skim over the verses 1 through 19, remembering, and hopefully you will remember the setting instead. The verse that I want to get to is verse 20. So we start off that we know in those days a decree was sent out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. Joseph went up from Galilee to Judea, the city of David, called Bethlehem. He was to register with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. We know that in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field. Angels appeared to them, and they were filled with great fear. They, the shepherds, were told good news of great joy that is for all people. Born in the city of David, a Savior, who was Christ the Lord. They were told where to find a baby, and suddenly a multitude of angels appeared, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace among those with whom he is pleased." Then the shepherds decided to go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which was made known to them. They went with haste, and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby, Jesus, lying in a manger. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. Can you imagine being one of those ones who received that good news from the shepherds? Now we're at verse 20. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told to them. The shepherds had to leave the very first Christmas scene, Joseph, Mary, and the baby Jesus. Yet, they did not leave disappointed, or they did not leave with any other negative description. Instead, they returned to their fields, to their flocks, glorifying and praising God. Listen, after Christmas, there should be praising and worship. As we read in Luke 2, verse 20, then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told them. After finding Joseph, Mary, and Jesus, the shepherds returned to their fields, returned to their flocks. They were glorifying and praising because of the truth. You see, everything they found in Bethlehem was just as the angels said it would be. Give praise and worship to God for the things we have heard. It says in Luke 2, verses 10 and 11, and the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Jesus, he is the anointed Savior and has full power to save, for he is Christ the Lord, and therefore he is able to save to the uttermost all that come unto God by him. That is why the angel said to the shepherds, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Savior means deliverer, redeemer. This child who is to become the deliverer is the Messiah, Jesus Christ. In a time of great darkness, God promised to send a light who would shine on everyone living in the shadow of death. He is both wonderful counselor and mighty God. This message of hope was fulfilled in the birth of Christ and the establishment of his eternal kingdom. He came to deliver all people from their slavery to sin. So why is there a letdown? Give praise and give worship to God for the things we have seen. In Luke chapter 2, verses 9, 12, 13, 15, and 16, let me read those for you. "And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear." That's verse 9. Verse 12, "And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in the manger." Verse 13, "And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying," 15, "when the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And verse 16, "And they went with haste, and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger." You see, just as the shepherds, all of us should be excited and exuberant with lovely simplicity and devoutness and faith. They are not taken up with the angels, the glory that invested them, and the lofty strains which filled the air. They weren't taken up with that. Nor did they say, let's go over and see if this be true. They have no misgivings, and neither should us. But let us go and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us. That's what the shepherd said, and that's what he's given us in his word. Hasn't God made known to us also the truth? Jesus, the incarnate one. Doesn't this confirm the view given in Luke chapter 2, verse 8 of the Spirit of these humble men, these lowly shepherds in the fields, guided by God, went with haste, even left their flocks, and were mysteriously guided by the Holy Spirit to the right place through the obscurity of night by placing their trust, just as we are to do. In all of our circumstances in life, place our trust so we can find our Lord. There should be no letdown today. After Christmas, there should be proclaiming and witnessing. In Luke chapter 2, verse 17 and 18. 17. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. Verse 18. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. Everything was the truth, just as the angels had told them. They saw the Christ who would save his people from their sins. The shepherds told everything, and they told everyone what the angel Gabriel had said about the baby. Probably the angel had said a lot more to them than we have in this record. Yet, what they said, proclaimed, and what they witnessed astonished all who heard it. You see, good news is not to be kept to ourselves. When we have ascertained its truth, we are to tell it to others. And we are especially to tell the good news of salvation. Tell it, O ye who know in your own hearts by blessed experience. Tell it, though it will sometimes be with broken accents in the feebleness of your flesh. Yet even then, tell it in the passion of your heart's affection. And God will bless your testimony, and others will learn of the good news through you. So now that Christmas is past, the one day chosen to honor it, live every day proclaiming and witnessing of your own wonderful experiences, as the shepherds did when they returned to their fields. They returned praising God for all they had heard and all they had seen, proclaiming and witnessing of their own wonderful eternal Savior. There should be no letdown after Christmas. Now's the time to pick up, to be lifted up, and carry that good news on into the new year and every day after that. You see, we're people who follow Jesus, and we choose to follow his ways. And we have an opportunity and a calling, each one of us, to be a city on a hill and live our lives in such a way that it shines a bright, radiant light in the darkness. We accomplish this by trusting in Jesus Christ and by leaning on his word, by allowing God to give us specific instructions and allowing his word to encourage us to be a people who are the church. We are the church. We don't just do church. In John 16, 33, verse 33, it is written, I have told you this so that you will have peace by being united to me. The world will make you suffer, but be brave. I have defeated the world. What an overcomer is Jesus Christ. He overcame the world. And it doesn't matter if you're making mistakes in life. It doesn't matter the damage that you're doing to society right now, because you can change that all today. Right here, right now, you can find grace and peace in God and allow him to let you feel that grace and peace. Allow him to take away all the guilt and all the damage that's been done. He'll give you a love that's eternal, a love that can never be taken away if you ever should mess up again and again. And you will always, always be able to run back to him, because he's waiting for you with open arms. As far as the east is from the west, his arms are waiting open. Today, You can choose to start a new life with Jesus Christ. You can have that real lasting peace and grace through a relationship with Him. But here's the dilemma. All of us have done, said, or thought things that are wrong. And this wrong is called sin. And our sins separate us from a pure, holy God. In Romans 3, verse 23, it says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Not just a few, not just 10 or 20, for all, everyone. But do you want to know the good news today? The good news today is that Jesus died in our place so we can have a relationship with God and be with Him forever and ever. You see, God reaches out in love to you, to me, to Stephanie. He wants us to be His children. And you can choose to ask Jesus Christ to forgive you of your sins. And you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your Lord and Savior. See what it says in Acts chapter 16, verse 30 and 31. "And after he brought them out of the inner prison, he said, 'Sirs, what must I do to be saved?' And they answered, 'Believe in the Lord Jesus as your personal Savior and entrust yourself to him, and you will be saved, you and your household, if they believe.'" And in Romans 10, verse 9, it says, "Because if you acknowledge and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, recognizing his power, his authority, and his majesty as God, and if you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved." You can make that confession right here today. You can do that through prayer. Would you please pray with me? Dear Lord, I need you. I know that I'm a sinner, and I thank you for dying on the cross for my sins. I ask for your forgiveness and open the door of my life, and I receive you as my Lord and Savior. Help me turn away from all sin and allow me to follow and trust in you as I become the person you, Lord, want me to be. I choose this day to enter into a relationship with you, surrendering my whole life to you, Lord. Please give me the grace, give me the courage to live as a disciple in your church for the rest of my days. And it's in your name, Jesus, that I pray. Amen. Amen. If you prayed this prayer, Stephanie, myself, all the saints, the heavenly host, say welcome into God's family. Welcome. And to those of you who have already been on a journey with the Lord Jesus, today is the day you can say thank you and refresh your vows to Him. In the book of Ephesians, chapter 8, verse 8, it is written, "For it is by grace, God's remarkable compassion and favor, drawing you to Christ, that you have been saved, actually delivered from judgment and given eternal life through faith. And this salvation is not of yourself, not through your own effort, but it is the undeserved gracious gift of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Last week, the word of the week, the word for the week, was faithful. God is faithful. This week, the word for you to think about, for you to place in your heart and dwell on, is great. G-R-E-A-T, great. God is great. What a wonderful day. What a wonderful time spending with you, sharing what God wants us to know. Stephanie and I, we want to thank you. We hope that you had a wonderful Christmas. And until we see you next Sunday, be blessed and be safe.